Why? Hello and welcome, everybody. So today I wanted to go ahead and bring you guys the 3.20.0 Path of Exile patch notes for Righteous Fire. So I'm not really going to be reading over the patch notes. I'm simply going to go ahead and read out kind of what I pulled from the patch notes on things that affect Righteous Fire. Now, for those of you guys who don't know, Righteous Fire has a serious contender, and may I say potentially better, variant, which is the Juggernaut version. This league, I will be focusing more on the Juggernaut version for two reasons. Number one, I've just played Inquisitor so much. And number two, Inquisitor actually got nerfed this season. However, remember that nerf does not mean deleted. Inquisitor is still very strong. It has its own pros and cons, which I have a separate video for, but we're not here to talk about that. So let's get started. Okay, right. So literally from the beginning, Eldritch Altars. Eldritch Altars have had their gem reward, to my knowledge, removed. The only reason I bring this up is because on my website, for those of you guys who don't know, under the crafting section, we talk about using quality fire gems for the plus one fire gem recipe. Now, this is not really too big of a deal because there are so many ways to accumulate fire gems, you know, such as Ritual, Expedition with Tuyin, literally picking them up off the ground, using your extra fire gems and RF gems after you get your 20 gem, divination cards such as the SRS one for 20% quality, and there's many more. Jewels. This is a big one. So, Conqueror's Efficiency, the thing you get from Wings of Vestiri from killing Yugle, that guy, is gone from the game. The reason this is a big thing is that for Righteous Fire, we use the Conqueror's Efficiency to get the three auras set up. Those three auras would be Purity of Elements, Malevolence, and Determination. Now, because that is gone, we are going to be modifying the POBs. Everything is already taken care of. Don't worry. We will not be using Malevolence right away. We'll be using Skitterbot until we can get a Mono Reservation Efficiency Jewel. They have already confirmed rare jewels roll 2 to 3% Mono Reservation Efficiency. I have already checked. This will be enough to warrant your swap. All right, curses. This is a big one. Overall, in my opinion, damage over time builds have received a massive buff due to curses. Previously in the past, it was very hard to scale your single target with builds when you are trying to push numbers past like 5 to 6, 7 boss damage or million boss damage. Not mapping DPS, but boss damage. It typically got extremely expensive because you're just chasing these, like, you know, +1/+1 amulets, +1/+1 weapons, stacking as many sources of dot multiplier, squeezing in mono reservation efficiency to get such as hold on, give me one second, Aspect of Spider, pushing forbidden jewels like Flesh and Flames, using the Maven jewels, I forgot what they're called, the ones that, you know, jump you all over the tree to get extra stuff. Now you can squeeze a little bit more reservation and say push for Whispers of Doom and get something like Elemental Weakness as a double curse. So TLDR curses now do not have their associated penalty on bosses and pinnacle bosses. Before, they used to have 33% less effect on bosses, I believe, and 66% reduced effect on pinnacle bosses. That is completely removed, and the gems themselves have been slightly nerfed to make up for the massive buff that they have gotten. Right, so more importantly though, curses. Hex Touch now has a 35% less effect on supported curses. This does affect our build. It does not really affect our bossing. For the most part, your boss damage will be very similar, still a little bit higher. For mapping, you may notice that rare monsters take a bit longer to kill. Now, thankfully, with the essential removal of the crazy Arch Nemesis stuff, this probably won't be too big of a deal. However, it's something that I may look into in the future. Now, if you notice here, I say for mapping, I think Hex Touch is still the way to go. However, for players looking to farm bosses, I would probably go with a self-casting alternative. Since Righteous Fire doesn't really have that many buttons to press, it's not too big of a deal to throw an occasional curse up. You can also do something with a trigger weapon. This is all a bit more complex. We're not going to worry about it too much. All right. So this already talks about the curses. Okay, good. One other thing to bring up is that Juggernaut, unlike Inquisitor, is so tanky because of its ascendancy, you do have the option of going staff. So for players who want to maybe push higher numbers and don't care too much about how tanky you are in maps, because you'll still be tanky against bosses, you do always have the option of going staff. Now, I was going to cover this in my POB, but unfortunately, it's really annoying to mess around with for an efficient version, so I've decided to dodge it. But for the most part, the advantage of using a staff is you won't have to use an Elder Helm. Instead, you can go after a unique item, which is very odd because usually with RF, you don't use a unique weapon. But here you get options like a Searing Touch, and your end game can be a Cane of Kulmak. Now, of course, you can go for a rare crafted staff. That's a lot more complex, so we're going to ignore that part. Okay, some other cool things. Onslaught Flask now scales with modifiers to Flask effect. It's not really a big one, but it's kind of just something unique. Cluster Jewel, Lord of Draw now provides your flammability curse can affect hexproof enemies. This is not something we usually ran, but it's just kind of interesting to note, right? We've also changed monster inflicted sources of chill and shock effect to be multiplicative rather than additive. This allows for sources of reduced effective ailments to stack and provide immunity. The reason I highlighted this is if you are playing a variant of my build and you're modifying it and you're not using Tempest Shield or you're not using Purity of Elements, if you're going the whole like reduced effective ailments route, you have gotten buffed by this change. You should not randomly just get a 20% shock on you when you have 110% reduced effective shock. This is awesome. Here is a big buff, especially to people who farm endgame content. The 50% increased life recovery from flasks while used at low life mastery has been replaced with nearby enemies have 50% reduced life regen rate. This is very big for players who are pushing progression, such as Maven witnessing. Whenever Maven says, "Take this vitality boon," and Minotaur heals from 50% life to 85%, that guts it by 50%. Throw in a frost bomb on top of that, you will barely even notice that. Also, just in general to monsters that regenerate life, it's not really something that you'll be able to notice, but anytime a monster regenerates life, that is directly countering your damage over time. So you can look at this as a damage multiplier against a lot of targets. So this is also just stating that there is a Pantheon that also has the reduced life regeneration rate if you have hit them. We frost blink a lot, we hit a lot. Okay, Inquisitor, nerf. The Inquisitor's Pious Path skill no longer provides 50% increased effect of consecrated ground you create. So this essentially is about 2.5% life and ES regen, which makes a total of about 5% regen loss. It's not that big of a deal. Inquisitor has crazy sustain already. The only times I can really see this being annoying is for players who are like transitioning to Aegis without melding. It'll be a lot, not a lot, it'll be a little bit harder to sustain your energy shield before the melding swap. At high end, you're going to be just fine. Don't worry about it. 25% curse effect reduction, not a super big deal. I mean, you're going to go from what, like 95% curse resist to 70%? You can get curse resist on the tree. You can get it on a jewel now, which would put you back to where you were. I don't think it's too big of a deal. Definitely a quality of life hit. And you lose a little bit of damage for monsters on the conch ground. I would say this is probably the biggest thing out of everything because you're always chasing for extra damage on RF. Although Inquisitor will still do more damage than Juggernaut around the same budget in the early game, just because Inquisitor still has more multipliers. All right, something interesting. We have introduced Fracturing Orb and Fracturing Shards and have removed the Harvest Craft that fractures a random modifier in an item. This is awesome for players who love to map, just like myself. It gives another incentive to farm Harbinger, which I think is fantastic. This is really cool because you can actually now fracture items on your Elder Helmets, which is pretty unique. So basically, you can try to get a locked in affix on an Elder Helm, fracture it, and then you can Essence Craft on top of it. So this adds a new way to kind of craft your Elder Helmet. Very excited, probably very expensive, but I would say it's probably realistic to acquire and potentially even SSF friendly. So Kirak SSF nerf. Kirak's giftiness for maps offered for this mission has been reduced. The chances for him to offer a more unique map is now more reasonable. So basically you get less unique maps. We've changed the outcome odds for Tainted Orbs of Fusing to be more favorable to match where they were in Scourge League. This is really cool for staff builds, in my opinion. Although there's not really that good of stuff you can get on Corruptions, to my knowledge, on a staff. I could be wrong. Staves are kind of weird for me. I've never really played them. But for example, you could like double corrupt your Searing Touches. I don't know what you can get. I feel like there's got to be something there. And then you can use Tainted Orbs of Fusing and Jeweler to try to get it where it is. In addition, we've added a new keystone that causes scarabs used in your map device to provide increased pack size rather than their usual modifiers. I like this a lot. I just think this is really cool. And then, other than that, we have the Kirak list of map mods. Essence is not on here, so it does suck a little bit for crafting, but honestly, I think we're going to do just fine and it'll be all right. For people who love playing Explode Righteous Fire, we do get Domination, which is extra shrines, and if you specialize in shrines on your Atlas, that's extra density as well. So I'm still very excited for the league overall. Other than that, the last thing to really say is I have been working real hard along with my buddy Jadeon to help update the Righteous Fire wiki. I already have the Righteous Fire Jug League starter. It's pretty much done. The Inquisitor is still from last league. I need to update it. The Juggernaut is pretty much done. So you can copy this. You can already start testing it out, start playing it. Obviously, POB is not updated yet, but I don't think there's really anything on POB that I would add except for that life mastery for the nearby enemies have reduced life regenerate. So this is here for you guys. Furthermore, don't forget, you can go to the FAQ where we have also touched it up a little bit, and I've also added some info for Jug. You will now start to see Jug, Jug in red on a lot of questions, and this is basically showing you that this is for Jug specifically, right? So essentially, if you just click anywhere, if it's for Jug, you will see it highlighted in red. Anyway, that's pretty much about it. Hope you guys have had a wonderful time. Hope you guys have enjoyed yourselves. Remember, if you did like the video, please feel free to like, share, and subscribe. You can catch me streaming live every day, but Mondays at twitch.tv/Pohx. One more thing to state. Actually, two more. Sorry, it's Sunday, not Monday. Next week, I believe on Monday or Tuesday, I'm actually going to do a fresh leveling run for you guys on the Juggernaut specifically, or I guess it'll be on a Marauder. So players who are struggling to level will have a VOD that they can actually watch, or you can just watch me live. And then after that, I will try to get the Righteous Fire League starter out. So sometime next week. And of course, I'm going to try to put out the Juggernaut and the Inquisitor. Now that's actually everything. So I'll see you guys all later. Thank you again so much for all your support. Take care, everybody.